hyperinflation, which under competitive conditions would be more likely to arise. And with hyperinflation, of course, people would then flee back into real values, and the money would become entirely useless. And you must be especially jealous to protect your monopoly position as the only one who can produce money. The more worthless the money is that you happen to produce. Now, in a way, you have then accomplished what all alchemists and their sponsors wanted to achieve. You all know what the alchemists wanted to do. They wanted to produce something valuable out of something that had no value at all. And what you have achieved by having a paper money monopoly is you have produced something that has value and purchases indeed something out of something that is entirely worthless, namely just pure pieces of paper. And just as alchemists, if they have accomplished this miracle of producing something valuable out of something that had no value at all, had to keep this secret secretly, this way of producing secretly, otherwise other people would imitate it, and then of course the alchemists would no longer be in the position that they were before. So you, as a money producer, must make sure, since you cannot keep the recipe of producing paper money secretly, that no one else can possibly do the same thing that you can do, namely producing the same types of pieces of paper. Now, if you have monopolized the production of money in a conscious cost-cutting effort, so to speak, having reduced the production cost and the quality of money virtually to zero, you have made a marvelous accomplishment. Unless you were a saint, that is, under the assumption that you are a normal person, you can and will now and forever print more money whenever you are in need for it. After all, it costs almost nothing to print it, and you can then turn around and buy yourself something really valuable, such as a house or a Mercedes for your paper. And you can achieve these wonders not just for yourself, but also for your friends and acquaintances, of which you all of a sudden discover that you have far more than you ever dreamed before. Including, of course, many or even most economists who explain then to the general public why your monopoly money-producing position is really good for everyone. Now, what are the effects of this? First and foremost, more paper money does not in the slightest affect the quantity or quality of all other non-monetary goods. There are just as many goods as before. There exist just as many consumer goods as before, and there exist just as many producer goods as before. Now, this immediately refutes the notion that is apparently held by most, if not all, mainstream economists, that more money can somehow increase social wealth. To believe this, as everyone proposing a so-called easy money policy as an efficient and socially responsible way out of economic trouble apparently does, is to believe in magic, that stones, or rather paper, can be turned into bread. Let me emphasize again that practically every mainstream economist who advocates that we should increase the supply of money in order to get out of the current financial and economic crisis is a person who believes in miracles. amount of presently existing wealth in society, that is, the total quantity of all goods that exist, it redistributes the existing wealth in society in favor of you and your friends. Those people who get the money first and spend the money first can still buy at the old low prices. And then prices are gradually driven up because the money supply has increased. And those people who get the money very late, or not at all, to whom it flows very late after the money is just moving from one person to another, so to speak, all those people receive now less in terms of wealth. If you have been on a fixed income, for instance, you are faced with a situation where all prices have gone up in the meantime, but your income, which was fixed, has remained the same. So those who get the money first become richer, relatively speaking, and those who receive the new money later or not at all are impoverished. So again, to emphasize, an increase in the total supply of money can never make a society rich. All it can do is redistribute existing wealth from one group of people to another group of people, and always from the group of people who get the money first, they are richer, and those people who get the money last, they are impoverished as a result of it. Now the problem for you and your friends, again, you are at head of state, for you and your friends with this institutional setup is not that it doesn't work. It works perfectly. It works always to your own and your friends' advantage and always at the expense of others. All you have to do is to avoid hyperinflation. Because if there's hyperinflation, then people will stop using money altogether. There will be a flight into real values, and then your magic wand that you can create riches for you, at least, out of nothing, will be taken from you. The problem with your paper money monopoly, if there is one at all, is only that this fact will be immediately noticed also by others and recognized as a big criminal ripoff that it in fact is. But this problem, that people will notice that you are up to no good, can be overcome too if, in addition to monopolizing the production of money, you also set yourself up as a banker and enter the banking business yourself with the establishment of a central bank, of a government bank. Because you can create paper money out of thin air, you can also create credit out of thin air. Credit is nothing else but paper money leveled out with the expectation of being returned plus interest. In fact, because you can create credit out of thin air, that is, without any savings on your own part, you can offer loans at cheaper interest rates than anyone else can do it. Even at interest rates as low as zero. And with this ability, not only is your former dependency on banks and the banking industry eliminated, moreover, you can make banks now dependent on you, and you can forge a permanent alliance and complicity between banks and state. You don't even have to become involved in the business of investing the credit yourself. That task and the risk involved in that, you can leave easily to the private banks. What you and your central bank need to do is only this: you create credit out of thin air, and then loan this money at And the banks, in turn, loan out your newly created credit to their business friends at somewhat higher, but still below market interest rates, and they earn them from the interest differential. And in addition, to make the banks especially keen to cooperate with you, to work together with you, you may permit the banks a certain amount of their own new credit. You allow them to create money on top of the money that you created. You allow the banks to expand credit above and beyond of the credit that you have created out of thin air. This is what we call fractional reserve banking. Now, what are the consequences of this monetary policy? To a large extent, they are the same as the ones that I described with respect to an easy money policy. First, an easy credit policy is also inflationary. More money is brought into circulation, and prices will be higher, and the purchasing power of money will be lower than would have been the case otherwise. And second, the credit expansion too has no effect on the quantity or quality of all goods that are currently in existence. This is all the same as in the first example that I gave. Again, more money is just, this is just more paper, nothing more. It does not increase and cannot increase social wealth by one iota. Third, easy credit also engenders a systematic redistribution of social wealth in favor of you, that is the central bank, and the commercial banks within your banking cartel that you established. You receive an interest return on money that you have created practically at zero cost out of thin air, instead of on money that you costly saved out of a given income. This is the way we do it, normal people do it. And so do the banks, who earn an additional interest on your costless money loans. Both you and your banker friends thereby appropriate what we may call an unearned income. You and the banks are enriched at the expense of all real money savers who receive now a lower interest return than they otherwise would have received without this injection of new credit. On the other hand, there also exists a fundamental difference between an easy print and spend monetary policy and an easy print and then loan out monetary policy. First off, an easy credit policy, that is print up and then loan out, alters the production structure, that is, it changes what is produced and by whom in a highly significant way. You, the chief of the central bank, can create credit out of thin air, as I said. You do not have to first save money out of your money income, that is, you do not have to cut your own expenses and thus abstain from buying certain non-money goods. This is, of course, what every normal person must do if he extends a credit. If I extend a credit to you, I must save out of my given income and then hand you over the savings. And the savings that I hand over to you represent goods that I have not bought myself, that I have not consumed or used. You only, central bankers, you only have to turn on the printing press and can thus undercut any interest rate that is otherwise demanded by savers of borrowers of money in the you will be paying a positive interest return on your paper money investment. And if they don't go well, as a monopoly producer of money, you can always make up losses more easily than anyone else, namely by covering your losses with even more printed paper. Without costs and no genuine personal risk of losses, then you can grant credit essentially indiscriminately to everyone and for any purpose, without concern for the creditworthiness of the debtor or the soundness of his business plan. Because of your easy credit, certain people, in particular investment bankers, who otherwise would not be deemed sufficiently creditworthy, and certain projects, in particular projects undertaken by gangs, by banks and their main clients, that would not be considered profitable or too risky, instead do now get credit and do get funding. Essentially, the same also applies to the commercial banks within your banking cartel. Because of their special relationship with you as a central bank and as the first recipients of your costless low-interest paper money loans, credits, the banks too can offer loans to prospective lenders at interest rates below market interest rates. And if things go well, again, they are an unearned income, receive an interest return. And if they don't go well, they can rely on you as the central banker, as a monopolistic producer of money, that you will bail them out in the same way as you bail yourself out of any financial trouble, namely by more paper money production. Accordingly, the banks too will be indiscriminate in their selection of their clients and their business plans, and more prone to funding the wrong people and the wrong projects. And there's a second significant difference between print and spend policy and the print and then loan out policy. And this difference explains why the income and wealth redistribution in your and your banker friend's favor that is set in motion by easy credit policies takes a specific form of a temporal boom-bust cycle. That is, of an initial phase of seeming general prosperity or of expected increases in future incomes and future wealth, which is then followed by a phase of widespread impoverishment when the prosperity of the boom period is revealed as a widespread illusion. Now, this boom-bust feature is a logical and physically necessary consequence of credit created out of thin air, unbacked by any savings, or as economists sometimes refer to this, by fiduciary credit as compared to commodity credit. I can give you credit that has a form of real goods, or I can give you credit that just consists of fishing net. He can eat the fish while he builds a net. With the net, he will be more productive as a fisherman than without a net. And this allows him to repay the loan to Robinson that he received. Robinson gets his fish back. It allows him to pay interest to Robinson. Robinson gets more fish than he learned about initially. And Friday can still make a profit, that is, earn an additional fish that was made possible due to the higher productivity of working with a fishing net. So again, Friday in principle, because he receives a commodity loan, is in principle capable of repaying his loan to Robinson plus interest and still earn a profit of additional fish for himself. But this is all physically impossible if Robinson's loan is only a paper note denominated in fish. So he hands a note that says, this is entitling you to one fish. But Robinson has not saved up a fish. He extends to Friday a loan that consists in nothing else but a paper note where it says fish. So Robinson's loan is only a paper note denominated in fish but unbacked by real fish savings. That is, if Robinson has no fish because he has conserved it all. Now then, and this is absolutely necessarily so, Friday must obviously fail in his investment endeavor. In a simple barter economy, of course, this becomes immediately apparent. Friday will simply not accept Robinson's note because he knows it is just a piece of paper. He would only accept it if it were real savings, a real loan, a commodity loan consisting of genuine fish. And because of this, it's because of the fact that Friday notices in such a simple primitive economy immediately what is going on, there is no boom-bust cycle that is getting started. But in a complex monetary economy, the fact that credit was created out of thin air is not immediately noticeable. Every credit note looks exactly like every other credit note. And because of this, the notes are also accepted by the takers of credit. But all of this, of course, does not change the fundamental fact of reality that nothing can be produced out of nothing, and that investment projects that are undertaken without any real funding, that is, without any savings backing them, must fail. But it explains also why a boom, that is, an increased level of investment, accompanied by the expectation of higher future incomes and higher future wealth, can get started. Friday does accept the note instead of immediately refusing it because he cannot immediately recognize that there are no savings backing the note. And explains then why it takes a while until the physical reality, so to speak, reasserts itself and reveals such expectations as illusionary. But what little is a crisis to you, and you are in charge of this whole thing? Even if your path to riches is through repeated crises brought about by your paper money regime and central bank policies, from your point of view, that is, from far more difficult to see through and recognize for what it actually is. Rather than coming across as a plain fraud and parasite, in pursuing an easy credit policy, you can even pretend that you are engaged in the selfless task of investing in the future, rather than spending on present frivolities. And you can even pretend that you are healing economic crises rather than being the one who actually caused them. Even government deficits, which are financed by the sale of interest-bearing government bonds to commercial banks or the general public, look like normal deficits in corporate bonds. The government must pay interest on its bonds, and it looks like it must productively invest its loans in order to do so. Yet in fact, the loans granted by commercial banks to governments are made possible only because your central bank first provides these banks with the necessary funds or reserves to then loan them back to the government. And in any case, the repayment of its loans plus interest can be always assured by your own central bank.